Let's talk a bit about two-factor authentication or multi-factor authentication. Any time where you have a password, usually a password, doesn't have to be, and then they ask you something else, like to verify your identity. So maybe they send you a one-time password through a text, or maybe you have to use an app like Google Authenticator to produce a one-time number. If I want to log into my online banking, I have to put my card and type my PIN into a device, which produces me a one-time password. It's this kind of idea. Everyone, I think, has a kind of intuitive idea of what the point of two-factor is, but let's sort of try and formalize it a bit and break down what it's good for and what it's not good for, and you know exactly what we're getting from it that we wouldn't otherwise have. The point of authentication is to verify to some server that's usually remote or your machine that you are who you say you are. And so in essence, you're then allowed to access the things on that machine or on that device. Passwords seem to be what we've settled on as a kind of happy medium. They are something we know, right? I have some knowledge that hopefully no one else has. And that means that I can type that in and verify it must be me because I'm the only one that knows what that is, right? If you want to know about what happens when other people know those things, then see the other videos we've done on this, right? Because I've talked about passwords before. So if your password is 6 characters long, it's being cracked right now, and it's being cracked quickly because we can go through all the 6-character passwords in a fraction of a second. Passwords are not foolproof, right? People pick bad ones and they get hacked. They can pick good ones and they still get hacked because of like a keylogger, maybe a keylogger or something like this. That's where two-factor or multi-factor authentication comes in. So usually we talk about these three things we can use to demonstrate that we are who we say we are. So we have something we know, a password or something else, a date of birth, a mother's maiden name. These are kind of common ones people go for. Something we have, right? Our mobile phone receiving a text message or our credit card or something like this, or something we are. Now, something we are is less common, but this would be biometrics or fingerprints, you know, iris recognition, voice recognition, where if we're going a bit more out there, gait recognition, that's how you walk, things like this. Usually demonstrating who you are has some kind of hardware involved, so is less common, right? And we're just going to put it aside for today. What we do is we combine something we know with something we have to make it that much harder for someone that finds out that thing we know can break into our account, right? So let's assume for a minute that someone's guessed my password. They don't have possession of my phone, hopefully. They don't know the PIN code on the phone. They don't have the app on the phone. So they can't answer that question when asked. So when they try and log in, they can get the password correct, but they can't get the second part of the puzzle. And that has two benefits. First of all, they can't compromise the account. But also, if someone's logged in successfully with a password, but unsuccessfully with the other part of the two-factor, that could flag a warning that then sends an email to the user to say, just check your password hasn't been compromised. If your password is compromised, even if it's not your fault, this stops someone breaking into your account. Right? This is why it's quite common on things like password managers, online banking, and other, you know, some email systems, and in fact, a lot of computer systems these days will see multi-factor authentication being used. But that isn't to say that it's always a good idea, right? There's this sort of opinion, perhaps, in security circles that more security is always better, and that I broadly agree with in general. But of course, you have to consider ease of use. You have to consider that some of these people aren't experts, and they haven't got that much time to be constantly checking their mobile for extra texts and things. Maybe they're trying to do this somewhere where there isn't any reception. Right? You can't just put on extra layers of security and it not a little bit hinder what people are trying to do. I think the idea of multi-factor authentication is to have a compromise between the additional security it offers and it being a total pain and never actually getting anything done. You know, so for example, on some software, you'll find that it only asks, let's say, for multi-factor for logging in on a new device. And once you've logged in, it will allow you to persist that session for a while. Things like this. The idea being that it's somewhat inconvenient, but it doesn't get a bit silly about it, right? Because this can come back and get you. Someone pointed this out to me when I was talking about this on Twitter, and you know that they've had a lot of friends who've accidentally been kicked off whatever server because they've lost the device that was producing something they have. Right? And that's actually happened to me. I used Google Authenticator to log onto one of my servers, and I lost my phone because it got broken and it went off to repairs. And for those 2 weeks, I'd completely forgotten. I mean, you smash your phone, the last thing you're thinking about is, oh, I must save my Google Authenticator passwords. You're not thinking about that. And it's gone, and then you realise, actually, I can't log into my Twitter or my server for 2 weeks. Like, in the end, I had to go in via the terminal on the server and reset the authenticator password, because which is a bit of a pain. So you can imagine it's quite easy to lock yourself out because you can lose that thing you have. So, you know, multi-factor authentication is a really good thing and people should be using it where security is a concern, right? But it's not a completely foolproof replacement for good passwords, and you can't really realistically use it on every single system you have unless you're just unbelievably willing to put up with, you know, inconvenience, right? If you're much more patient than me, because I, you know, I can't do it. I suppose to clarify, two-factor authentication is a subset of multi-factor authentication, which could have any number of authentication mechanisms. You could imagine combining all three of these. You see that on the movies quite a lot, where they look into something with their eye, then they speak out loud, and maybe they also type in a password. It's going to take them ages to log into anything, but, you know, that's the idea. So a good example is the hash-based one-time password, or one-time password, right? Which is at the core of Google Authenticator and numerous other tools for generating these things. So we're talking about you type in a password that you know, and then some device you have generates a different password that is only used that one time. And unless you know both of those things at the same time, you're not getting in. That's the idea. So I actually have Google Authenticator. So I can show you broadly what it is. There are lots of alternatives, like free one-time password, and numerous other apps you can search for that do this. All I've got here is Google Authenticator every 30 seconds rotating these one-time passwords. So you can see this little countdown here. When it gets to the bottom, it'll generate another set of passwords. And then I have to type in that password whenever I log in. So how does that work? Well, let's just talk a little bit about how it works. In actual fact, it basically ties back into our message authentication codes that we were talking about in a previous video, right? We had HMAC with a key, which would be used to generate two subkeys, but we won't dwell on that, and a message. In hash-based one-time passwords, or HOTP, we actually calculate the HMAC of a secret key, S, and a counter that we're counting up. Right. So the first time I log into this website, the counter will be 0 or 1. It's not important, right? But obviously my device that I'm using to generate these one-time passwords and the server have to be on the same number. Right? The secret key we've shared beforehand, hopefully not in plain text to everyone. Right? So it'll be some long string that the server gave me when I first created my account or when I first set up this authentication system. The idea is that we're combining our secret key that only me and the server know with whatever the counter currently is, to generate a one-off hash, which is then essentially shortened and turned into a small number. The way we do that is we take certain bytes from the HMAC, because that's going to be, for example, for an HMAC of a SHA-1, it's going to be 160 bits. So we take 4 bytes from here, we calculate those 4 bytes modulo 10 to the D, where D is how many decimal we want, right? So on my Google Authenticator, I was using 6. So your authentication app would have a certain number of digits it output. And what would happen is the server, when you log in, will perform the exact same calculation because they know the two things that we do. They know the secret key and they know the counter, right? Now I'll get onto exactly, because Google Authenticator extends this to use time, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But the interesting thing about this is in actual fact, it's really a second password, right? This secret key is a big long password that we have that is stored on my phone or my other device and stored on the server. So in some sense, that can also be compromised. It's still vulnerable to phishing and many other security issues. The problem with this, like, it's quite widely used. The problem is that you might accidentally get out of sync. Let's imagine that you generate one of these one-time passwords, but then someone phones you up and you get distracted and you wander off, right? Then you generate another one, you try and log in and you're out of sync and we've got a real problem. So we're going to use instead, and this is what Google Authenticator does, is use TOTP, or a time-based one-time password. So all that's happening here is we're replacing our incrementing counter with the current time, right? So that as long as me and the server are roughly at the same time, we can log in. Right? We still keep this shared secret between ourselves. There's obviously a few niggly details that we have to consider here. So first of all, what unit of time we're using. We can't use milliseconds because the chances of me and the server being on the same number of milliseconds is astronomically low, and I can't type in the one-time password in a millisecond from it to be. I mean, I can type pretty fast. No. So what we do is let's say round to the nearest or floor to the nearest 30 seconds. So what you would do is you would take the Unix time, number 5's on the Unix time, right? So, you know, link.
Somewhere buried deep down inside that system is a little counter.
But like Unix time divided by, let's say, 30, okay, and then the floor function, which basically goes down to the nearest integer. So what we're saying there is in 30-second blocks, generate a unique number, right, which in essence replaces this counter. Right? We still use an HMAC as before. Now, in practice, in case they're out by, let's say, a minute or 2 minutes, we might calculate on the server side C+1, C-1, just to see if they're close enough. Right? So for example, when I look at the password on my app, if it's about to expire, I can still type it in, because even if it's just expired, it'll still be allowed. Right? And it's a security parameter of these systems, is what the window size is. So I'm just oversimplifying this slightly. Actually, we can subtract a start time here. Right? The default is zero, which is why I haven't bothered to talk about it. But you can agree with the server a time to start, and you essentially take Unix time minus whatever your start time is. But let's not get into too much, in too much pedantic.
Presumably that helps with time zones, right?
Yeah. I mean, time zones cause a problem here.
That's for another video.
Yeah, I know, right? If only we had a video on that.
Presumably these little pin pads that we get, I call it a doofer, from the bank.
I think doofer is the technical term.
Do they work in the same sort of way?
Very similar. So smart cards are actually perhaps a little bit smarter than people think, and they actually perform encryption and all kinds of things. What that machine will do is essentially a challenge response. It will send a request of a card for it to perform a certain cryptographic function. The card asks for the pin, you supply a pin, and it performs a function which is then turned into a one-time password. Right? So it basically verifies that you are both in possession of your card and have the pin, right? Which is good news. Other banks will work on this kind of principle with a time-based system. And hopefully they ask you plenty of times. So in my bank, to log in, I have to use this device. And then to send any money, I also have to use this device. And this stops the classic replay attack and time of check, time of use issues, where I've logged in, wandered off, stupidly left my online banking logged in, and then someone has at all my money, which would be not quite as much as they'd like. I've always had a slight concern with the multi-factor authentication they've used in Star Trek, where they read out their password aloud on the bridge in front of everyone else. I mean, okay, yes, so the voice recognition part of it, that's something they have, maybe you can't steal that, but now everyone knows your password. Let's hope they rotate them daily. I'm sure they'll have solved it by then. That'll be the least of their problems.